Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning how to prepare for your lab practical. So if you're watching this video, hopefully you're a Chem 3A student and you are trying to figure out exactly how to prepare for your lab practical, which is probably within the next week, and you might be a little bit stressed about it. So this is my attempt to try to make a review video. So this is my first time really making one for all the students of Chem 3A. So if you are my student or another student, then as always, I would recommend using this video for caution. If you are my student, obviously keep watching, but if you're another student, keep in mind that every professor does do the practical a little bit differently, but we do tend to all try to follow the same general standard when we are administering it. So almost everything I'm saying should be relevant to you as well, but make sure you do listen to your professor and exactly how they instruct you for your video, or sorry, for your practical. So let's go take a look at it. We're going to dive in exactly to what to expect for this, what's the format of it, and then we're also, whether it's at the end of this video or in a future video, we'll dive into kind of the major concepts of what to expect in each lab. So let's take a look. All right, let's first talk about what exactly should you expect when you walk into your laboratory practical. The first thing is generally within a week before your practical, your instructor will assign a time slot for you to show up. This activity is an individual assignment, meaning it's testing you on your laboratory knowledge that you've accumulated over the course over the entire semester, meaning that we'll separate you into two groups. So being that there are approximately 30 students in a lab section, there will be 15 that will be in the first half, 15 in the second half. Now, what does that mean? So when you assign your time, you got to show up on time. So for example, let's say if my class starts at 11 a.m., that means half the students will be at 11 a.m., the other half will be at 12:30, which is the approximate halfway point for my section. So every section will be a little different. So you must show up on time. That is crucial. Now, the big reason why is depending on how fast the actual assignment or lab practical will start. If you show up late, there's a big chance you will miss parts of the practical that you cannot make up. Sometimes you might get lucky and then maybe you could, if you miss a station, maybe you can make it up along the way. But most of the time you are out of luck and you will miss those points for your practical. Now, keep in mind when you show up, so the second your instructor opens the door and you're there, you need to show up not only on time, but already wearing your personal protective equipment, your PPE, right? So which is your lab coat, your goggles, pants, closed-toed shoes. You need to be wearing those things ready to go into the room and to do your assignment. This can be a part of your grade as well. There are many instructors that will take off points if you are missing any of these, because remember, this is testing you on your laboratory preparedness to see if you know the proper lab skills before moving on to your next courses, right? So you need to show up with those things in mind. If you forget those things, you could lose anywhere from 5% to as much as 50% of the grade that could be deducted, depending on who the instructor is. Some instructors will even send you home and then you're just out of luck. So keep that in mind. You want to make sure you don't do that. If you have to, the night before, put some extra clothes in your car if you have to, so that way you have them. All right, the other thing is, not to freak you out, but it's just because it's serious, right, when you're doing this, is you want to, in your lab coat pocket, put your calculator and put a pen or a pencil as well, just some whatever you want to write with throughout the activity, so that way you have that ready to go. Now, when you come in, the next thing is your instructor is going to let all of you in one at a time and assign you a starting position. It's what we refer to as a station. So you're going to see essentially stations all around the room. It's going to go from 1 through 10. And there's going to be all these different spots that they're going to tell you is where you're going to start. So the first thing you do when you come in, you'll put your backpack at the front of the room with your phone, any bags you might have, anything that essentially that you can't use on the exam, they'll all go by the front. Then you're going to go to your station, which then you're just going to kind of wait until the start of the actual session. So just go there. Do not touch anything. Don't talk to anybody. Just stand there ready to go. It's supposed to be a very serious thing. So when you're there, just be ready to work when essentially your instructor tells you further. Okay. So now from there, the way that this part can work, it depends on how when they hand out the versions. So there are three different lab practical versions. You might just get the version when you walk in. Other instructors may go around the room handing out a different color-coded answer sheet for you to fill out all of your info, all the station info, all your answers on. And that's going to be the version you're going to be following the entire time. So you can get A, B, or C. They are different colors. So for example, let's say if I have B, what I'm going to be doing is every time I'm at a station, I'm going to be answering question for version B at each station as I go. So you ignore the other versions. They don't apply to you. You're doing your own practical throughout the entire thing. So there's going to be multiple different versions and everybody's going to have their own, essentially their own test. So now when you get there with that version, you got to keep in mind that when everybody's in place, there will be a timer set at the front of the room. Usually it's shown on the projector screen where you're always given 4 minutes to complete the station. And then 1 minute afterwards, so it's like a 1 minute warning of after the 4 minutes to clean up, to switch stations, to wrap up. So by the end of the 1 minute, you should already be standing or ready to go at the next station pretty much. So keep that in mind. Overall, you have about 5 minutes to do whatever it is that you need to do. So when we talk about what to expect at each station, it has to be something doable in that first 4 minutes. So it has to be something faster. So don't try to study all these crazy things that are going to take you hours to do. It has to be doable in a few minutes. So now from there, let's go look onto our next part. So let's talk about how the entire process works once that timer starts. So the time has started. What you're going to be doing is you're going to just answer your version. So if I had blue, I'm going to be answering version B for my station. So when you're doing this, keep in mind the whole station is something that's doable in 4 to 5 minutes. So when you're studying, you want to try to be studying concepts of things that are manageable in that time frame. You're not going to be asked to do an entire experiment in 4 minutes. That's not possible. So when you're looking at something that's doable, it's designed to be finished in that time period. So if you are someone that's running out of time, one thing to keep in mind is just write down the question, because usually you're always given time at the end to work up your question. So if, let's say, when I came into the room, I was in my lab coat ready to go, and I was told by my instructor, you're going to station 6. So what you're going to do at station 6, when the timer comes, you'll flip over your station card. It will have the question. You're going to answer question 6 in the number 6 answer box on your version sheet. So it's going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way to 10. You will start on number 6. Now, when you're answering that, the thing to keep in mind is none of these are multiple choice. They're things that you should have mastered or understood by this point, or at least ask your instructor if there's something that you needed further help with. So all of it is free response questions, meaning they're calculations, maybe balancing, maybe measuring something. They're all things that you've been working on throughout the semester as you work up your labs. Now, when the timer goes up, that is when you'll rotate to the next station. And typically the way these are working is that they're always in increasing order as you go. So if you start at 6, you will then rotate to number 7. Now, the nice thing is you're always going to be following the same person. So there's going to be another student at, let's say, the station next to you. They're going to be going in front of you. So you're always going to follow the same person. So if I'm at 6, I'm going to follow the student at number 7 the entire way through as it's increasing. Now, there might be also, depending on how big your group is. So being that there's only, 10 stations that are there. Well, if you remember, I said there could be up to 15 students. What that means is that there's going to be something called a rest stop at different points around the class, meaning that between certain stations there might be an area where you can kind of just relax for the 5 minute window of opportunity, or you can finish up other questions. So you might see that there will be some of them, and your instructor will notify you if that's something they are doing for that session. Every time it is different. It depends on whether or not, it depends on the number of students in your time. So at the end, what you're going to be doing, so you'll do all 10 stations. Generally, this takes about an hour and a half or so, to an hour and a half. When you're done, you're usually always given about 5 minutes at the end just to wrap up your questions, maybe answer something if you didn't get to quite finish it, just to make sure you get as many points as possible to pass your lab practical. So keep that in mind as you are doing that. So let's go look at the next part. So what can we test on in this entire thing? Well, there are many things that we can always test you on when it comes to chemistry, because as you kind of learned throughout the semester, there's a ton of information. It is a lot that goes into introductory chemistry. So the first thing is, did you show up properly in lab, right? So wearing that proper PPE and wearing your lab coat, goggles, all that stuff is one of the first things. You know, does that tell me that you essentially treat lab as a professional environment, because you want to be a professional one day in your life as well, where you're a healthcare worker, a scientist, or whatever it is, you got to wear proper PPE in your career. So this is something that you need to be tested on, right? Make sure you can do that. The next thing is really, can you do measurements? One of the most crucial things that you need to get out of this class is, can you do measurements? Because in every career, especially in STEM, or the health sciences, measurements are the backbone for what we do. And in many cases, if you don't do measurements correctly, it can lead to a lot of different problems in a lot of different careers, whether it's lawsuits or maybe even worse, where someone could get injured or hurt. So you need to be able to do the basics, right? So the first thing is, you have to write down everything you're doing when you're at these stations. A lot of times there's partial credit that can be awarded at every station, especially when it comes to showing your work, writing your calculations down, showing that you know something about the problem. So write down all of your units, write down all of your significant figures, know the basic idea of how to measure things like tick marks on glassware and how to actually approximate the number of sig figs when you're going through them. So those are going to be really important, right? Sig figs have been drilled into all of you every single day in every homework assignment. Of course, it's going to be a part of the lab practical. That doesn't go away. Measurements have to be precise. They need to be accurate as well. So keep that in mind. Now, the next part is equipment. Can you name basic glassware that you use in your labs? This is the easy point questions, right? You should know what a beaker is, what an Erlenmeyer flask is, what a thermometer is, what a pipette is, what a volumetric flask. If some of these names are things that you don't recognize, then I would recommend reviewing your glassware. There's a couple ways you can do this depending on how your teacher set up your course. One thing is that there's probably a study guide in Canvas that has probably flashcards in it of all the glassware. The other thing, in many of our lab manuals, we have a list of all the glassware with pictures for you to refer to. So those are all really useful. Make sure you're aware of the general purpose of a lot of glassware. There were a couple labs where you might have used something that was really unique and a little weird, and you haven't seen it in maybe 2 months. So make sure you kind of review and go through those introductions, because they're going to help you remember really what it is. Read the intros, look through the post labs, see how you did your calculations. It will help refer your brain to exactly what you did. Now with calculations, one thing you see is like I put a 50% with a plus next to it. Well, the whole idea of reason is, most of this test is calculations. That's most of all chemistry is. It's a math class in disguise, is what I always say. So one of the things is, all of your data workup is fair game. That was the biggest part of the lab, right? You spent maybe an hour or two collecting data, and probably 5 to 10 hours working up your lab report. So you need to be comfortable doing your data calculations. Now, once again, I'm going to say this again, it has to be something doable in 4 minutes, right? So it has to be short. It can't be something that's really, really long. So you're not going to be asked to go from start to finish of an entire lab going through 20 calculations. It's going to be something short and sweet, whether it's like maybe balancing a chemical reaction, maybe figuring out the theoretical yield of something, maybe do a limiting reagent calculation, maybe do a pH calculation, maybe do a gas law calculation, things you've done in lab. So it has to relate. And then the last thing is really knowing your terms, right? You don't want to come to a station and be like, I don't recognize these words. That's the worst feeling, especially if you might know it if you were reviewing your terminology. So make sure you remember all like the different techniques that were used, at least the basics, so that way if you had to perform something or if you had to do a calculation about it, you need to be able to recognize them. Make sure you're able to know how to use and measure things based on what's being asked of you. So there is a little bit of language and vocabulary that's used all the time that could be a little different, right? Whether it's knowing what concentration is, right? What units is that? That's molarity, right? You got to be familiar with that. Knowing if I say, oh, we have this hydronium concentration or hydrogen ions, being able to connect the dots, that's going to lead to pH, right? So there's little things like that that you need to make sure that you're familiar with. Now, another thing is when it comes to the calculations and the terms, you're always given reference materials to help you bridge that gap, whether it's the formulas you are given or reference sheets to help you. So whether it's the periodic table or maybe your green sheet for knowing your solubility rules, if it's something that's used in the problem, it's going to be provided. So if you're trying to I need this thing on this question, then there's a good chance you might be thinking about it the wrong way. You could always ask your instructor a question if you believe something should be there and it's not. But always feel free to ask, but it should always be there in front of you. So be familiar with your resources that are available. Now, so this entire video, so this is the end of this one. So being that this will be part one of this video, just giving a broad overview of really what all this is about. Part two is going to be longer. It's going to go into the specific experiments, essentially kind of talking about what are the overall ideas that you need to know about and how to really, what to look for in each lab, what's something that's doable. So just to kind of remind your brain of what each one is. So this was the introduction. I hope that this does help you prepare for your practical. I hope that you pass your practical. Whether if you're my student, absolutely, I hope you absolutely pass it. And if you're someone else's student, make sure you do check with your professor that you are familiar with everything that's required of you, so that way you do prepare for it adequately, right? We all do it a little bit differently, but we all follow the same general idea. So good luck, and I will hopefully see you in part two, where we will talk about each lab we completed this semester and the basic idea of what you could have to solve in each one.